I was in the Air Force during the Vietnam War. I first went over with a squadron of 25 pilots, and only three of them made it out of there alive. Most of them wound up getting shot down, and a lot of them wound up being POWs for the rest of the war. I was squadron commander of what they call a munitions maintenance squadron. It was the best assignment I ever had, and I spent 24 years in the Air Force, active duty. We were flying 60 aircraft missions a day out of there, and so it kept us busy. And of course, a lot, you actually slept on the flight line and underneath the airplanes and everything. It just, you didn't have any regular routine. It was just business 24/7. All of us were experiencing the thing for the first time. None of us had the experience or the background for what the job that we were there to do. Hardest thing for me, and it became most memorable, is the fact of all the people that were the pilots that we lost, because we lost, had very high losses. And when they would take off each day, four or five of them just never came back for the various reasons, and a lot you begin to, that was very difficult to deal with and realize that was part of the game.
Please join me for the invocation. Merciful God, you have given us the great promise of democracy. We come now to honor and praise those brave citizens whose military service has protected our nation and strengthened our cause. May all we do here today give them their worthy recognition and honor. Amen. Ask you to join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. We'll be led by the Boy Scout Troop 936. Cub Scout Pack 197. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Order. Please welcome the co-founders of the Actors Theater of Indiana, Cindy Collins, Judy Fitzgerald, and Don Farrell, for the singing of the national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight for the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare bursting in gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave?
Welcome. I'm glad all of you have joined us for the City of Carmel Veterans Day ceremony. My name is Jim Brainard, I'm the Mayor of Carmel, and I'm honored to stand before so many heroes. There are several other partners I'd like to recognize before we get started. I'd like to thank Pastor George Davis for that wonderful invocation. It's also appreciated that our Scouts and Boy Scout Troop 194 and Cub Scout Pack 197 joined us during their school day to help with the Pledge of Allegiance, as well as the talented Indiana Actors Theater Trio, Cindy Collins, Judy Fitzgerald, and Don Farrell for that beautiful rendition of the National Anthem we just heard. We're also proud to have our Carmel Veterans of Foreign War Post 10,003 and Carmel American Legion Post 155 join us for the presentation of colors. Our Carmel Fire Department Pipes and Drums Corps add such a wonderful element to this event as well. I wish to thank everyone. Carmel is fortunate to have numerous supporters of this event. I want to thank American Structure Point, American Members Credit Union, Drs. Locke and McLean, Optometry and Eyewear, and UN Communications Group. I appreciate their continued support for this event. I also like to thank Wyatt Photography for the photo banner displays that were created for our event today and are in the theater lobby. Many of the veterans featured in these displays are attending today, and thank you to those involved, and again to Wyatt Photography. I want to thank the Tarkington Theater, personnel, and the organization for the use of the space and staff assistance. I know that they're preparing for the Elf musical soon, and I believe they asked me to make this plug. Tickets are still available, so. We are here today to honor every woman and man who's ever worn the uniform of our nation, those who've selflessly secured America's promise throughout our history. That same history teaches us that security doesn't just happen. It demands effort, sacrifice, courage, and commitment. There's an old song from the 1960s that says every generation has to win freedom anew. And so it requires generations of men and women willing to defend our freedom for people they've never met and will never know. And so we're here to say thank you and remember those that have fought and served our great nation to preserve our freedom. We also are reminded of the sacrifices many families have made and become acutely aware of the hardships they continue to endure in order that we may live free. It is important for us to come together each year as a community to thank those who took great risks and remember those who gave their lives to protect our freedoms. Our debt to these heroes can never be repaid, and our gratitude and respect must last forever. We pause from our daily lives to observe Veterans Day, a day to help preserve in the hearts and minds of all citizens the spirit of patriotism, the love of country, and the willingness to serve and sacrifice for the common good. This time, will you please join me in a moment of silence and honor those who have bravely served throughout our history in the armed forces and for those who are defending us today against the threat of terror. Thank you. I'm not sure we can ever thank our veterans enough for the sacrifices they were willing to make in order that this great nation and its principles would endure. We are proud of the veterans in this community and that they call Carmel their home. Let's give them a round of applause. We're also proud that many of our veterans have continued their dedication to public service as employees of the City of Carmel. As you can see listed in today's program, there are more than 70 City of Carmel employees who have served or are currently serving in the military. One of these employees is our Corporation Counsel for the City of Carmel, Doug Haney. Doug has been the Chief Legal Officer for the City of Carmel since 1997. His undergraduate and law degrees are from the University of Wisconsin. He also holds a master's degree from my alma mater, Butler University, an LLM graduate law degree from Georgetown University in Washington, D.C., and a PhD from Walden University. Dr. Haney served in the U.S. Army as a Special Associate of the U.S. Army. He also taught for many years and an adjunct instructor at Indiana University. We've asked him to share his thoughts as a past and current public service. Dr. Haney, the podium is yours.
Again, thank you, Mayor Brainard. As you will learn, I was asked to talk a little bit about my military career and then about my subsequent employment with the city and how it's related to how the city treats its veterans. And as you'll learn, my military career was not one from which legends are made. However, I am very thankful to have had the chance to serve my country in this way. In 1974, I walked up to the University of Wisconsin Army ROTC office and signed up. Now, for those of you who lived through the 60s and 70s, you know that Wisconsin was a hotbed of anti-war protests, which included the blowing up of the Army Mathematics Research Center, killing one researcher and injuring three others. So you may wonder why a Wisconsin freshman wanted to join the Army, at least our Army. I joined because, honestly, for many years in high school especially, I had watched our boys return from Vietnam only to be jeered at, spit on, and shunned by many in the very country for which they fought and too often died. And I was personally sickened by that. And I vowed to myself that by my service, I could in a small way speak for the silent majority who still respected the soldiers, sailors, and airmen who served our nation whenever and wherever duty called. So that's why I joined. My mother was not happy. The first thing I learned about the military was that you'd better get used to moving around. Even as a cadet, I spent the summer of 75 jumping out of perfectly good aircraft in Georgia, the summer of 76 in boot camp in Kansas, the summer of 77 serving with an improved Hawk missile unit in Texas and New Mexico. I was commissioned as a second lieutenant in field artillery in 1978, and after graduating from law school in 1981, I entered active duty as a captain in the Judge Advocate General's Corps. I was stationed primarily at Fort Belvoir, Virginia, although I had a short stint in Fort Leavenworth, just visiting, not as a prisoner. At Fort Belvoir, I served as the Fort's Labor Counsel, then as a litigator, and finally as its Chief Trial Counsel. During that time, I also taught the law of war and prepared last will and testaments for the soldiers who were leaving Virginia for Lebanon, Grenada, and other places of conflict. And I was often struck by the sense of duty and honor exhibited by these soldiers who were leaving their loved ones and putting themselves in harm's way for our country. Fortuitously, I entered active duty just as a new commander-in-chief was bringing a renewed sense of pride and purpose to a military that, at least in my opinion, had been sorely neglected and effectively neutered during a period of post-Vietnam malaise. As such, my years on active duty were very rewarding. I left active duty in 1985, fully intending on serving in the Army Reserve while practicing law in the private sector, and I perhaps naively expected my military experience to be seen as a positive or at least a neutral light by private employers. And to my surprise, I learned that this was not the case. I found that it was still cool in many circles to paint service members as frankly dumb, backward, or socially out of step. And despite laws to the contrary, I was quietly informed that missing work for deployment or for military training was not the way to make partner in a civilian law firm. I therefore regretfully ended my military career. However, when one door shut, another is opened, I made one of the best decisions of my life, right behind marrying my wife, Tammy, I love you. I applied for Carmel's newly created assistant city attorney job. In January of 97, in an obvious moment of weakness, the city hired me. That was 22 plus years ago. I can now confidently report from personal observation and knowledge that the City of Carmel goes out of its way to credit military service and to value the positive traits of confidence, honesty, sense of duty, and acceptance of personal responsibility that it instills. Public examples of our city's support of our military are obvious. They include this Veterans Day and Memorial Day ceremonies and our wonderful Veterans Plaza. As a city employee, however, perhaps the most telling example of city support for our veterans is found in that while, according to one study, less than 4% of Carmel's residents are veterans, three times that number, over 12%, of the city's employees are veterans or are currently serving in the armed forces. Moreover, I can report that the military obligations of these employees are appreciated and accommodated, not merely tolerated. That pretty much says it all. So I will simply end by thanking again Mayor Brainard and our counselors for making Carmel a place where service members are hired, supported, and respected. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug. If you're a veteran celebrating with us today, would you please stand that be recognized for your selfless service to our country? As a token of our appreciation, the city has a gift for each of you, courtesy of American Structure Point, Drs. Locke and McLean Optometry and Eyewear, and the City of Carmel. Please come forward to this table in the front, where I'll be joined by Carmel American Legion Post 155 Commander Andrew Carson and Carmel VFW Post 10003 Commander Richard Lear to present each of you with a token of our appreciation. Share a steel cuff-style bracelet with a nickel-finished engraved with the words, Carmel Veteran.
Thank you. are grateful for your acts of courage. Our flag waves proudly as it has before. We're thankful that now you stand here with us. We express appreciation yet once more. We've set aside today to give you honor. And today we stand to give you praise. You have kept us safe, protected us from danger. Champions of liberty ablaze. And we say thank you for your gift of service. We say thank you for your gift of care. Thank you to these honored servants, safe keepers of the land and sea and air. Of civil service. Lord, bless us and keep our nation free. And we say thank you for your gift of service. We say thank you for your gift of care.
Thank you
to these honored servants.
To those of you who may not know, Cindy Ensign Baney, on the piano, is a longtime supporter of our Carmel Veteran Programs and the choir director at Fishers Junior High. She is also the daughter of Bill and Dorothy Ensign. Bill was president of the Carmel Clay Veterans Memorial Corporation, and the song that she just played is entitled Honor. She wrote it for her father and all other veterans. Thank you, Cindy. We are fortunate to have a talented individual such as Cindy who recognizes the sacrifices made by veterans. And we're blessed to have some very active and dedicated veterans in our community. More than 10 years ago, we unveiled the Veterans Memorial built just west of us here at Freedom Circle in City Center. A patriotic statue of a man and woman in uniform holding a flag now graces the pedestal that long stood empty. It gives us a place to go to reflect on the sacrifices others have made for freedom. It should be noted that we located Freedom Circle in City Center, Carmel's new downtown. We purposefully place this memorial in the heart of our city so that all residents and visitors will come in contact and be able to see the memorial frequently. I hope that you visit it, enjoy it often. I want to give a special thanks to those who served on the now dissolved Carmel Clay Veterans Memorial Corporation for providing a last reminder and tribute to our veterans for Carmel to enjoy for generations to come. As part of our Veterans Day ceremony activities, we hold poster and essay contest for youth throughout our community so they can be involved in thanking our veterans and learning and reflecting on what service to our country means. This encourages meaningful discussion between students, their parents, sometimes their grandparents and great-grandparents, and their teachers. Each year, we get letters from teachers telling us how they appreciate being able to incorporate Carmel's Veterans Day ceremonies into the school curriculum, and parents who are thankful they had the opportunity to discuss the military service of family members and others with their children. The poster contest is for children in elementary grades 5 and lower, and the essay contest is for middle school age children. We invited participation from all schools, public and private, located in Carmel, Indiana. While not all schools chose to participate, we had a number of posters and essays submitted, and I'm very proud of the quality of the contest entries we received. The theme for this year's contest was Honor and Country. The posters and essays were judged by representatives from our local veterans organizations and the Carmel Arts Council. This year, each winner will receive a monetary prize from our student contest sponsor, Indiana Members Credit Union. The gift cards are intended to be used towards education or school supplies. We want to thank Indiana Members Credit Union for their support of this portion of our Veterans Day program and providing the gift cards. Poster winners will receive a $50 gift card, and essay winners will receive a $100 gift card. Joining me in honoring the poster contest winners this year is Dr. Michael Beresford, the new superintendent. Not so new anymore. My notes said new. The superintendent of Carmel Clay Schools. We are glad you're here, Dr. Beresford, and appreciate the work you do for our students. At this time, would the poster contest winners please walk onto the stage and stand next to your winning poster over here? Come on up. It's like the game show on TV. Come on up. Ostara, is that your name?
Ostara.
Ostara. Ostara Zajac. Would you like to tell us about your poster, Ostara? First of all, what grade are you in?
Kindergarten.
And which school you're at?
Carmel Elementary.
Okay. Tell us about your poster, Ostara.
That's Uncle Sam.
That's Uncle Sam, okay.
Yeah.
Speak right into that microphone. And what's around Uncle Sam?
Stars.
And what's this up here?
That's an eagle.
That's an eagle. Is that on a flag? Yes. Ostara is shaking her head, yes. Well, it's a beautiful poster, Ostara. Congratulations.
First grade.
First grade. Which school are you in?
West Clay Elementary.
You're in West Clay Elementary. Would you like to tell the audience about your poster? Shake your head no. Well, would you answer some questions if I asked you some questions? Well, you have to. You want that gift card, don't you? Yeah, okay, you have to do that. So let's turn around and look at your poster. I see a soldier with a flag, is that right? You're shaking your head yes. What's overhead?
helicopter.
And then what's it? You've written some words on the top left. What do those words say?
Thank you for your service.
It's a very beautiful picture with a lot of bright clouds. What is your name?
Sophie.
And where are you in school, Sophie?
Town Middle Elementary.
And which year of school are you in?
My second year.
Your second year in second grade. So, Sophie, would you tell the audience about your poster?
I started off with, I made a circle, and then I put, I made a heart, and then I made the flag in the inside, and I made it a world around it. And then I wrote honor and country on the top, and then I put red, white, and blue on the outside of it.
Red, white, and blue on the outside.
Yes.
It's very beautiful. Congratulations. Well, what is your name?
Pia.
And where do you attend school and what year are you in, Pia?
Town Meadow. And I'm in third grade.
Okay, tell us about your poster. You're a very good artist. It's very good.
So I drew a veteran. And I mean,
this is a woman soldier, I see. Yeah.
And I drew wavy lines on the outside of it, and I colored it red and white. Then I had some extra space, so I wrote onion country, and then I drew a star, then I colored the rest in blue.
You've drawn it very nicely. It's very artistic. Thank you. Congratulations. What's your name?
Hadley.
And where do you go to school and which grade you're
in? Carmel Elementary, and I'm in fourth grade.
So you're one of the older kids at Carmel Elementary now. One more year to go, right? Okay. Tell us about your poster, Hadley.
I drew a bald eagle, and its wings are supposed to look like the American flag, and I wrote, honor the soldiers who protect our country and its camouflage.
The audience may not be able to see it, but that is a really good bald eagle. I wish I could draw like that. Did a very nice job. Congratulations. Okay, you're in fifth grade at Carmel Elementary. Tell us your name.
Elise Castor.
Elise, would you like to tell us about your poster?
Yeah, I knew I had to do something with the sun, because why not? And so I did the sun. I did tie-dye, sort of, because I thought that would look nice, and then I knew I should probably add some soldiers. So I did that. It's kind of like they're silhouetted against the sun.
It's very pretty, Elise, and I didn't see it as tie-dye, but you can see it now. And the sun, it's with the shadows of the soldiers in front. It's absolutely beautiful. Congratulations. If all of the winners would walk to the right and go off and then go down the stairway, there's some ladies there that will hand you your gift cards. Congratulations to all of you. I'd now like to introduce the Orchard Park Elementary School Choir and their director, Julia Walker. We are proud to have them join us today to help celebrate our veterans as they perform Sing a Song of Peace.
Nation.
Thank you. That was beautiful. Now we will hear from our essay contest winners. Our essay contest judges commented how impressed they were with the entries they received, as there were many creative stories and poems this year. I want to congratulate all of this year's winners, as well as our teachers who continue to encourage writing in the classroom. Our first speaker is our sixth grade winner, Deva Arier, from Clay Middle School. Devia? There she is.
When I think of the word country, various thoughts come to my mind. In my opinion, the most important thing for a country is freedom. There are many different types of freedoms in the United States, including the freedom of speech and freedom of religion. These freedoms can influence other rights to make free choices. To me, honor is being yourself. By that, I mean not being afraid to be someone who stands out, being able to think for yourself, as well as doing what you believe to be the right thing to do. There are some people in this world who want to be considered as an honorable person, even though they just follow others and don't really think for themselves. It takes a real individual with a good sense of self-worth to stand up for themselves to think. I think that veterans symbolize and bring out the best of both definitions of country and honor. Throughout history, many veterans have left their families to fight and risk their lives for our country. That is one reason why they get honored. When they have to fight, some are scared. Even though they were scared and hungry, they still fought hard and proud, and that is what made them an honorable person. On Veterans Day, we honor and thank all of the military who served in the United States in all wars, especially living veterans. Veterans Day was originally called Armistice Day, which became a legal holiday to honor the end of World War I, which took place on the 11th day of the 11th month at the 11th hour. It is celebrated by having parades and fun activities, and in many places, the American flag is hung at half-mast. Some schools are closed on Veterans Day, but choose to mark the occasion with various activities. As you can see, the words honor and country define veterans. Veterans serve and fight for their country. So let us pause to celebrate those who have served and continue to serve our great country.
Our next speaker is Jewel Wang from Clay Middle School, our seventh grade winner.
In Flanders fields, the poppies blow, between the crosses row on row, by John McCrae, Canadian Lieutenant Colonel. Last spring break, my family and I visited Belgium. One place we went to was Flanders Field. This field was where French, Belgian, and British expeditionary forces fought against the Germans for freedom during World War I. Throughout our stay, we visited many memorials covered with graves and many names of the ones who died. It was very humbling for me to see how many people were willing to sacrifice themselves for their country. At the end of the day, we watched the last post ceremony. This was extremely touching for me to see that the soldiers were honored every day for what they did for their country and for the world. Before I saw the ceremony, I always wondered, why would someone fight in a war when they could be killed or permanently injured? I always thought to myself that I would never want to fight in a war because I wouldn't want to die. After the ceremony, I had a new understanding that it was not about if you live or die, but it was about honor. It was about the new respect you gain, the new lens people see you through. Even if you don't survive, people are still thankful. When you die fighting in a war, it is an honor to die for your country. It is an honor to fight for your country, and you are honored for willing to fight. These people who save millions of lives are not only saving the people of their country, but they are also saving the future of mankind and the new generations to come. When you think of this, then you think you might not be living a life like this if it was not for the soldiers who were willing to die for your freedom. I can now understand what honor means and how saving one person's life is saving more than you might think. I am honored to say thank you. We are the dead short days ago. We lived, felt the dawn, saw sunset glow. Loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders Fields, by John McCrae.
Our next speaker is the eighth grade winner, Anna Kindsfather. Anna?
Honor and country. Those two words hold such sentimental value. When those two words are spoken, most people probably think of something big. Something so beyond average that a normal person couldn't accomplish those titles. Personally, I don't think that's the truth. I believe that honor and country have multiple meanings. Honor doesn't have to be something big and extraordinary. Honor is to live daily through loyalty to your country and its freedoms. Honor is to have respect. Honor is to accomplish your goals no matter how little. Honor is loyalty to not only yourself and your country, but others around you. Being a part of such an amazing country is an honor. Being a part of something bigger than yourself and your needs is an honor. To have the option and opportunity to say that you are part of this country is an honor within itself. Every person deserves to be respected, but veterans deserve so much more than just respect. Veterans risk their lives to save ours. Veterans are real life heroes that are our protectors. Veterans leave their lives and their families to serve our country and to give us all our own sense of safety. Honor isn't always recognized, but it really should be. To be able to have honor and be honored means that you have achieved high respect for yourself and that you live for others, not only yourself. Just by being able to state the fact that you are honorable and loyal to your country is a great achievement within itself. Honor and country are two words with great meaning that can often be indescribable and hard to recognize. But these two words are the structure and building ground of what America is and means.
Thank once more all those who participated in our honor and country poster and essay contest. I think it's reassuring that our younger generation has great appreciation for and an understanding of the sacrifices of their ancestors and in some cases their family members. What those family members have done to keep our country free. We will now hear once again from Cindy Ensign Baney and the Orchard Park Elementary School Choir as they play a musical tribute to our veterans. This is part of the ceremony where we get to see which branches of the military are represented here today. So when you hear the theme from your branch of the military, please stand and let us recognize you.
Thank you.
Thank you. It is now my honor and privilege to introduce our keynote speaker, Lieutenant Colonel retired Pete O'Hara. Mr. O'Hara entered the U.S. Army active duty in 1978 after being commissioned as second lieutenant field artillery from the Ohio State University ROTC program. His first duty assignment was as a battery fire direction officer and battery executive officer with the 2nd Infantry Division Artillery in the Republic of Korea. He served in a variety of planning and training officer positions in North Carolina, Germany, Honduras, and Kansas. During Operation Desert Shield, Desert Storm, he served as Division Fire Support Officer, where he and his staff planned, coordinated, and executed the largest artillery preparation since World War II. He also worked at the Pentagon in the Office of the Deputy Chief of Staff for Operations and Plans. His final duty was in Indianapolis, where he trained all National Guard and Reserve soldiers in Ohio, Indiana, and Michigan. He retired from the U.S. Army in 2000 with multiple decorations. He currently teaches United States history and psychology at Carmel High School. Please join me in welcoming Lieutenant Colonel Pete O'Hara.
First, I'd like to thank everyone for this. This is a great event. I really appreciate it. And it's an honor to have been asked to be here and to speak with you all today. Now, I have an unpaid political announcement. And that is that if anyone is interested, you get to hear a great speaker on Monday at 9:30 at Carmel High School if you want to join us with our Veterans Day celebration there. We, the people of the United States, have inherited a right to be free, the right of particular privileges and immunities, the freedom of personal choice, action, and thought. For over 240 years, Americans have enjoyed a sense of rights and freedoms unequal in any other part of the world. But the privileges we enjoy did not come without enormous sacrifice. American servicemen and women have been on the front lines of protecting our freedom and defending our unique way of life for all of these 243 years. From the shot heard around the world, through the Civil War, two world wars, Korea, Vietnam, the Persian Gulf, and on to Afghanistan, Iraq, and the War on Terror, soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines have endured a tremendous personal sacrifice to ensure our freedom. As we go to work or school or play today, there are young men and women who have not had a home-cooked meal in months. They are sweating in the desert. They're freezing in the dark, windswept night. They have not had a hot shower in days or weeks. They sleep in sleeping bags on a cot next to an infantry fighting vehicle, or a howitzer, or a tank. They never get a day off. They face constant danger. Some may be wounded. Some may die. They patrol the streets of cities. They climb mountains. They slosh through swamps. They trudge through the jungle. They guard the demilitarized zone in Korea and countless outposts throughout the world. They train at Grafenwehr and Hohenfels and the National Training Center. They sail the oceans and soar through the skies. They leave behind spouses and children, mothers, fathers, sisters, and brothers. They are American servicemen and women, and they serve proudly. So there I was, in high school, looking for a way to get my college education paid for, and I applied for and received an Army ROTC 4-year college scholarship. So off to the Ohio State University, where I graduated and was commissioned a second lieutenant in the United States Army Field Artillery. Now the plan was 4 years, do my artillery thing, come out, go to law school, go into politics, maybe. Didn't work that way. I was on a hill in Germany, in Grafenwehr. I was a battery commander. My firing battery is out in front of me. It's 2:00 in the morning. It was freezing. It was the middle of winter. We had had a snowstorm the night before. It's snowing again. My battery is firing and firing. Again, 2 o'clock in the morning, I'm freezing. I got a cup of coffee in my hand trying to stay a little bit warm. And I realize my friends back home don't get to do this. I am good at it. I like it. And I stayed for 23 years. So fast forward about 7 years. I'm at Fort Riley, Kansas. Out of nowhere, the Iraqi army attacks and goes over and takes over Kuwait. All of a sudden, things change drastically. We no longer are fighting against the potential Russian invaders. We're fighting against a dictator on the other side of the world. Our division, the 1st Infantry Division, the big red one, gets called, and our mission, our motto is no mission too difficult, no sacrifice too great, duty first. So we are called, and we are always the first unit on the ground, and I get to be in the advance party, one of the first guys on the ground, one of the military planners. I'm the artillery planner. We find out when we get there that the plan is to make a big sweep to the left, attack north into Iraq, and by the way, we're going to fire the largest artillery preparation since World War II. I got 90 guns from units all over the Army working under me and the 1st Infantry Division. I plan, execute, and coordinate this massive artillery barrage. It was successful. We go on as the Allied main effort to defeat the Iraqi Army in brilliant fashion. One other quick little vignette, I'm at the Officers Club in Hanau, Germany. There's about 50 of us there at a function, having a very good time. We are in our dress blues. It's a formal affair. Our families are there. It's 1988, and one of my friends came in, and he has a VHS tape that we got from back home, and that's the way it was in, you know, 58. We didn't pull out our phones. We had to have a wait till the mail delivered us a VHS tape. So we get this VHS tape. We put it in. He says, "You got to watch this." We put it in, we watch it, it's Lee Greenwood. It's Lee Greenwood, and he's got a song. It says, "I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I'll gladly stand up next to her and defend her still today. For there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA." And when he said, "I'll gladly stand up next to her," 50 officers, never heard this song before, 50 officers stand at attention, and we stood at attention for the rest of that song. That'll always live with me, the dedication of those young men right there over in Germany, separated from families. But today's not about me. It's about the farmers who stood with Washington and crossed the Delaware River on a freezing Christmas night. It's about the soldiers who stood shoulder to shoulder at Gettysburg and Antietam, Shiloh and Fredericksburg. It's about those who served in the forgotten wars, the War of 1812, Spanish-American War, the Philippine-American War, the Indian Wars, the war with Mexico. It's about those who lie in Flanders Field from World War II. It's about the greatest American generation, people like my father, who served 4 years in combat. I can't imagine it. 4 years in World War II. It takes great courage to stand up and risk your life for your country and way of life. It takes great commitment to endure the cold, rainy nights in the jungle or the hot, burning sun of the desert. It takes great heart to leave friends and family and the comforts of home for extended periods of time. It takes unquestioned loyalty to the American way of life and to the American people to be willing to always stand up for your country. For millions of veterans, it is a privilege to have served. Today, we take time to honor American veterans. On the anniversary of the end of World War I, the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, we celebrate American freedom and those who have served the United States of America. An anonymous soldier created a little sign and posted it on a tree on a firebase in Vietnam. And it said, "Freedom for those who have fought for it has a special meaning that the protected will never know." Let us never take those freedoms for granted. Let us always remember those who have fought, sacrificed, and given their lives so that we could inherit that right to be free. So I'll close today by reciting the second verse of a great American anthem. It goes, "Oh, thus be it ever when free men shall stand between their loved homes and the war's desolation. Blessed with victory and peace, may this heaven-rescued land praise the power that made and preserved us a nation. Then conquer we must when our cause is just, and this be our motto, in God is our trust. And the star-spangled banner in triumph shall wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave." I thank you very much for your kind attention and duty first.
What an inspiring talk. I want to mention, as we walk over to the memorial next door, I appreciate everyone's patience with the construction for the Chris Kindle Mark and the ice at Center Green, and hope that you and your families join us this winter and participate in this Carmel tradition. The opening of both the ice and the market Saturday, November 16th, with festivities beginning at noon. Please do walk with us, if you like, over to the Veterans Memorial Plaza to place carnations at the foot of the statue and listen as taps are played at Veterans Plaza. The trumpeter will be Carmel High School band student Noah Flegg. And so after we close with our benediction, please exit using the west doors to the building, this sign, where carnations will be passed out near the doors. Be careful crossing the street. Thank you for attending today. And now please welcome back to the stage Pastor George Davis for the benediction and then the retiring of the colors.
Let me introduce VFW Commander Lear just for a moment.
Yeah, as he said, I'm the commander of the Carmel VFW, and this afternoon we have a free lunch for all veterans, so everybody's welcome. You don't have to be a member, of course, but all veterans, you're welcome to come over to the VFW right after this ceremony, and we have a free lunch for you. Thank you very much.
Would you join me for the benediction? Gracious God, guard the brave men and women of our military. Give us as well the sound courage and sure purpose that we might preserve and nourish our nation as a haven of justice and peace. With gratitude for all who would keep us safe at home and abroad, may each of us live our thanks and rededicate ourselves to the honor of citizenship. Amen.
Bye. served in the United States Air Force at Offutt Air Force Base in Omaha, Nebraska, as an orthopedic surgeon. I was a major in the United States Air Force. The reason both my sister and I served was primarily the example of our father, who came to America from Norway when he was 16. He was working in Brooklyn, New York, when Germany invaded Norway, and he was so mad at the Germans that he joined the U.S. Army. He was very proud of America and the opportunities that it gave him. He was a combat veteran. He saw a lot of combat, a lot of rough times during the war, but it inspired us to serve in the military.
I was in the Army. I was in the field artillery. I served in Vietnam, and in Vietnam I was assigned as an artillery advisor to the 25th Vietnamese Division. We had a special forces outpost that was being overrun at nighttime, and it was raining and it was windy. And they sent out some helicopters, one to pick me up and a couple of helicopter gunships, where we were going to go in with the gunships and try to break off the enemy attack on the special forces. It was dark, it was rainy. You know, once I got over the target area, I could only see one strobe light, and I needed two so I could figure out how to lay the fire in. And in the meantime, I'm talking to the guy on the ground, and he's begging me to start shooting because they're coming, you know, through the fence. But I had to find him first, and finally I figured out as best I could, because you don't want to shoot your own guy. You know, it's the enemy you're trying to push back. So finally, I thought I had him, and I lined the chopper up, and he began his run, and it turned out I had it right, and it was a thank you, Jesus moment. But it always felt good when you came back, and you did what you had to do, and all your guys got back.